morning, everybody. How are you this morning? Awesome. It's good to see so many people coming back to church finally, man. It really is good to see you all. Guys, we're going to get started with our worship service this morning. If I can get you to stand with us and sing out loud for the Lord. They are having some technical difficulties back there this morning. So, you know, we're going to push on and do what we do. So, praise God. You ready? Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we were made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Are we the church? We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. We refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive's hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray and revive this earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty changing heart. You made us so much more than this. Unleash the kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. We are your church. We are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our strength and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray.
Thank you, guys. You can be seated. Thank you.
Get a little worn down in between, like a bull chasing. Morning, everyone. Hi to the people in here and to the people watching online. Hello to you as well. So today is our fall kickoff day. So we have some things in the works and some things starting that are coming up. So first thing is life groups. They restart this week. If you haven't signed up for a life group, you can do so on smithfieldchristian.com, and you can sign up for any of the three that we're doing this fall. Also, the teen life group starts tonight at 5:30, and there's going to be a special kickoff with a campfire, and dinner will be provided. Also, we have a drive-through trick-or-treating experience coming soon. So we're going to have an informational meeting next Sunday after church if you are interested in helping with that or if you want some more info. So be sure to come to that. That'll be super fun. Also, we have Parents Night Out. Parents Night Out is going to be October 3rd this year. Registration is open today. So you can go to smithfieldchristian.com and you can register. Because of the nature of COVID and everything, we don't want any kids sharing supplies, so we definitely want you guys to register so we know that you're coming so that we can get those supplies for your kids. Lastly, we have offering. If you'd like to worship through giving, you can do so by going online, or if you're watching, you can click the giving tab. We also have the offering plates in the back near the door if you want to give that way. So I'm going to go ahead and pray for us and for offering. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us all here today. Thank you for allowing us, even if we're not in this building, to listen to your word and to engage with our fellow Christians. I want to thank you for bringing more and more people back slowly. We're becoming back to what we used to be, and I'm so thankful for that. God, I ask that you just calm our minds and our spirits while we're here today, and we're able to focus on you and focus on exactly what you want to get to us today. God, I thank you for everyone that is worshiping through giving. I thank you for their giving heart, and I hope that we can encourage others and just spread the ministry through that giving. Thank you, Lord, so much for this day and for being with us. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Hey, Troy, so make sure we do a volume check on this real quick. Had to switch guitars. Guys, we're going to continue our worship service. Can you just stand up with us, please, and sing?
Lifting
you guys.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. Your rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. Won't we all? 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name.
You guys want to lift this up with me?
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, I worship His holy. Worship Your holy name. Oh, I worship Your holy name.
Thank you, guys.
Just
Thank you so much for singing with us. You can be seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I love you. Thank you. Joe's going to talk about Exodus today, a dark time in life. This communion meditation comes from another dark time. When World War I erupted in 1914, British statesman Sir Edward Grey declared, "The lamps are going out all over Europe. We shall not see them lit again in our lifetime." Grey was right. When the war to end all wars finally ended, over 20 million had been killed, 10 million of them civilians, and another 21 million injured. While not on the same scale and magnitude, devastation can also occur in our personal lives. Our home, our workplace, our church, our neighborhood can also be shrouded by the dark specter of conflict. This is one of the reasons calls us to be the difference makers in our world. The greatest difference maker in our world is Jesus. Jesus came to guide our lives. He gave us the word so that we could read it, we could understand. He brings us hope in sometimes a very hopeless world. And then he gave his life for each one of us. You know, communion reminds us our sins are forgiven. We don't have to worry about those anymore. I mean, doesn't mean we go on sinning like Paul said, but our sins are forgiving. Jesus is our instrument of peace. As we go to communion, just remember, there are conflicts in this world, and there are people living in conflicts every day. And we can do that. We can live in them, and we can be a part of them, or we can let Jesus rule our life. And that's what communion reminds us. He died for us. We don't have to be a part of that conflict anymore. He gives us peace because he loved us that much. He gave his life for each one of us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you, Father, for loving us as much as you do. As undeserving as we may be sometimes, thank you that you gave your life as a sacrifice for those sins that we have sinned and the sins that we are probably going to sin in the future. Help us to be your servants, Father. Help us to do your will. Help us to keep our focus on you and not on ourselves. Again, thank you for loving us as you do. Thank you for this time that we can come around a table for that reminder. We do it every Sunday. We are blessed to be able to be reminded. I know that I personally need it every single day, but thank you for that we can come here to this table right now to be reminded of the wonderful love that you have for each one of us. You are truly an awesome God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. Just a reminder before we get into our prayer time that if you have prayer requests throughout the week or praises too, we would like both of them. You can go onto our website, smithfieldchristian.com, and you can submit them on there so that we can then make sure that we get them in for the email that we send out each week so that all of us can be praying and lifting each other up. So this morning we want to be praying for Keith Allen Lambert, who has health issues with his brain. Melinda Gallego had shoulder surgery and has to have another surgery too. The Cirillos would like for prayer for Dick. And we also want to be praying for the Gulf Coast as they recover from the hurricanes, and be praying for our country as well. We just have a lot of stuff going on in our country right now, and with the election coming up too. And for John Hardigan, who lost his wife suddenly. He's a friend of David Moose. And our neighbor, Jean, she is an elderly woman, and she was taken to the hospital last week with some health issues, and be praying for her, and also for Sarah Wigman, who is having gallbladder surgery on the 25th. So we pray that that is successful. I'm glad to see each of you this morning, and I pray for each of you as well. That God is using you and touching your lives every day. So pray with me. God, I thank you for a beautiful weekend, and I thank you for the cooler weather, and just for everything that fall brings for us, God. And I pray for all the prayer requests that were listed and also those that weren't, God. And I just pray that you put your hand on each of those situations and just give comfort and peace to those that need it, encouragement to those that need it, love to those that need it, God. And just remind us daily how much you love us and how you're always with us. And I thank you for our congregation. I thank you for our community. And I pray that you continue to bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.
So the book of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis is all about beginnings. I mean, that's what Genesis means. It's all about beginnings. If you go there, we see creation. We see everything kind of being brought together, being made, being brought into existence there. We also see the beginnings of God's relationship with mankind. We also see even the God's covenant begin to be brought into place because of sin. We see the beginnings of that severed relationship and God then making covenants with his people, and kind of because of that ruined connection, the fact that we had a relationship that was begun and it was so nice and it was as it should be, but then our sin came in and ruined that. And we even see after creation, we see the situation with Noah. We know about what happens with Noah. God gets so sort of upset and disappointed and frustrated with mankind that he says, I got to start over. And so he tells Noah, build a boat. Out in the middle of the desert, build a boat, Noah, because we're going to start over. We even then see that sin comes in to sort of the family situations, and there is conflict and turmoil within families. We see Jacob and Esau being some of the big ones that we see very often, very beginning of things. And even with Joseph later on, we see his situation with his brothers and his family and the different things that happened there. But at the end of Genesis, in some ways, Genesis sort of ends on a positive note. God steps in through Joseph, even though there was terrible struggle and turmoil in Joseph's families with his brother. And look, there's a whole, you know, story there that I'm sure a lot of you know about, the situation of Joseph being a knucklehead and kind of bringing a lot of it on himself. But God uses those situations and brings the end of Genesis kind of to a positive resolution. There's even a little bit of honor when Joseph comes at the end of his life, and the death of Joseph is kind of how Genesis ends. There's even a bit of honor there with sort of like the God's hero passing away. Joseph even tells God's people in Genesis 50:25, it's recorded, this is at the end of his life, he says, God will surely come to your aid. I don't know, it's almost like in my mind, I'm picturing, you know, like a Braveheart moment at the end of his life. He's like, don't worry, guys, God's going to be there for you. And so there's like this happy ending as we come to the end of Genesis. It's a very encouraging kind of thing. But unfortunately, it doesn't keep up going like that. And you know, things kind of change, not right away. Surprisingly, you may not know this, but 400 years after the end of Genesis, the events that happened in the end of Genesis, 400 years later, we come to the events in the book of Exodus. There are 400 years that separate this. And what happens, I think probably the most pivotal statement that is made at the beginning of Exodus, as we shift from sort of the happy ending of Genesis into the trouble of Exodus, we see in Exodus 1, verse 8, it says, then the king, to whom Joseph meant nothing, came to power in Egypt. That phrase right there, a new king to whom Joseph meant nothing came to power. If you remember, again, Joseph, when he was brought up through kind of in Egypt there, brought through Pharaoh's courts, eventually God brought him to a place of prominence and power and influence, and God used that to literally save nations, save them from a famine. Joseph, through his wisdom, was able to ration off food to be able to protect them and provide for them and help them out in that way. And because the king of Egypt saw how God was blessing Joseph, Pharaoh was led to honor God in the same way and was led to follow him. But unfortunately, we see here that a new king arose who knew nothing about Joseph, and so that means he knew nothing about God. Now again, this all did not happen very quickly. This happened over time. The first two chapters, though, of the book of Exodus actually cover 40 years. 40 years of Moses' life. He starts out in the very early part there, and then there's 40 more years after the first two chapters of where he's in the wilderness. We know about those situations. We're going to see those in a few weeks as we study on in the book of Exodus. And then there's 40 years at the end of them, as they're kind of, or I'm sorry, 40 years of when he's in the wilderness as a shepherd, and then 40 years as they're traveling on, the God's people has freed them from Egypt, and they're traveling in the desert. We're going to see that later on. But the reason I show you this, the reason I'm talking about this, is that we kind of know that the book of Exodus doesn't cover a very long period of time. It's 120 years, but Genesis covered thousands and thousands of years. And Exodus covers a much relatively shorter time. But the whole point is that we see this arc of things going well. We see throughout Genesis, things are developing, things are new, God's blessing, God's working, things are going along. But then all of a sudden, a new king comes into power who does not know God, does not know Joseph, doesn't know his God. And things for God's people take a drastic turn. I think in many ways, where we are today in our culture, in our world today, we can kind of, I don't know, almost feel like we are there in the beginning of Exodus. Now, please understand, I'm not saying that we're in the same situation of as God's people. We are not in the same situation as the Israelites. We're not as bad as what they were suffering of slavery in that way. They had things much, much worse. And I want us to make sure that, and this happens sometimes when Christians, American Christians, study the Bible, we want to take America and kind of put it in place of God's people, and we want to think that America is God's people, and that's not at all what the Bible tells us. It tells us that Christians all around the world are God's people. But I believe that we are in a kind of a similar situation of what God's people were experiencing in those days, of the fact that we don't know what's coming. We're walking into a very difficult, we're in the midst of a very difficult and sometimes dark time, and there's all these different feelings of feeling like we're trapped, or feeling we're lost, and feeling we're in the dark, or hardships that are kind of creeping in. But God calls us to still trust and follow him through these times. And it's because of books like the book of Exodus. And really, I think it's kind of like the whole reason that we have most of the Old Testament. I believe that one of the big reasons that God gives us the majority of the Old Testament is to remind us that no matter how dark, no matter how difficult, no matter how lost we may feel, there are reasons to trust and follow God. We can look at things that took place long ago in our past, in God's people's past, and we can see how God was faithful, God protected, God guided, and we can be reminded that God is still faithful today, and God is going to carry us on. You see, you and I, we're kind of stepping into literally a new season in just a couple weeks or so. We're going to step into fall, but we're also kind of, this time of year, we kind of all move into a different kind of, we kind of transition into a new feeling of we're heading into that last quarter of the year. We're heading into the end of this year, and some of us are saying hallelujah, amen, the end of 2020, and we're kind of looking ahead to the new year and wondering what the new year holds for us. But because of that, we don't really know what's coming. I mean, truthfully, we've never known what's coming. No one ever knew, you know, when we celebrated Christmas last year, none of us ever knew that this would be what we are today. But because of our current state of our world, you know, whether it's the pandemic or political conflict or the racial unrest that there might be, there is a lot of uncertainty right now. And a few weeks ago, we talked about how that can take a toll on us mentally and spiritually and just kind of wear us down. And how everything can kind of be bearing down on us right now, and we can feel very overwhelmed and very lost. And so, over the next few weeks, we're going to study the book of Exodus. And we're doing this on purpose at this point in the year, because I feel like for the Israelites, there was lots of unknown. There was lots of darkness. There was lots of troubles going on for them, and they didn't know what was coming next. And I feel like, again, not in the same situation, but in many ways, we're in a very similar situation. There's a lot of unknown ahead of us, and we want to trust God, and we want to follow God ahead as we move ahead into the end of this year and as we move into a new year even after that. But I want to kind of get something clear about the understanding of the situation of what the Israelites were in in the book of Exodus. It begins, of course, you know, we know that name Exodus kind of means to leave or to go out. It could even mean the word or the phrase to exit. So just looking at this, we know that God's people are going to be brought out of something. Now, God's people didn't know this. They were not like, hey, we're living out this book that's going to be called the Exodus one day. We know that from this end, but they didn't know that at the time. But God is going to kind of come in, and he's going to save his people, and he's going to bring them out. So if you have a Bible and you want to go to Exodus chapter 1, each week, again, we're going to be studying, and we're going to not go verse by verse. We're going to kind of take big chunks, and we're going to look at different parts of the book of Exodus. But if you want to jump in there, we're going to be in Exodus chapter 1, and verse 6 is we're going to start. There's Bibles in the seats in front of you, or feel free to get out your digital device and follow along there, or you can follow along the screen. So it says this in Exodus chapter 1 and verse 6. Now Joseph and all his brothers and all the generation died, but the Israelites were exceedingly fruitful. They multiplied greatly, increased in numbers, and became so numerous that the land was filled with them. Then a new king, to whom Joseph meant nothing, came to power in Egypt. Look, he said to his people, the Israelites have become far too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous. And if war breaks out, we'll join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country. So let's kind of pause there for a second. One of the biggest, I think, issues is when we kind of go into the Bible and we study the Bible and we kind of read through it and we're trying to understand what's going on and the different situations there, is that sometimes we forget that everything needs to be placed within a certain time frame, a context of what was going on. You see, when we look at different parts of the Bible, especially what's called like a narrative account, like what we're looking at today of a retelling of an event or a story or whatever's going on, sometimes we forget that there were other things that happened that just weren't recorded. There are things within this time period that went on that aren't in the Bible. And so sometimes we think, you know, Genesis ends and then Exodus begins and there's like no gap in there, right? But there really is this big gap and there's other things going on. And so we need to recognize that Joseph didn't just die one day, and then Pharaoh started to hate God and hate God's people. No, and there is a lot that goes on there. Some scholars actually believe that the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh at the time when Joseph came up to power, some believe that this Pharaoh actually grew up in very common means, which was part of the reason why he was maybe very sympathetic to Joseph, knowing that Joseph grew up in common means but saw how God was blessing him and said, well, maybe I'm going to, you know, use this man to try and lead our nation this way. And so he had some sympathy. But the thing is that time went on. In fact, we see that there are some scholars believe that there were seven more pharaohs that lived then after Joseph's death. And we come to eventually one, where there was one that came to power who was not raised in common means. And he didn't come from very common beginnings, but had maybe a higher kind of lifestyle. And so not only did this guy not understand what these common folk maybe grew up with and what they went through, he probably didn't even like the idea that such a commoner could be given such power, who wasn't even from Egypt, an outsider who had so much power. And so the persona and the identity and the ideals of Joseph and his God, they were no more at this point. And so the reason for this history lesson that I'm giving you this morning is that over time, the people of Egypt, you know, see, they started out kind of appreciating and loving and following and honoring God. But over time, even the people of Egypt, they began to drift from God. And you and I, we drift away from God. That's just kind of what we naturally do, unfortunately. We drift away from God. And we need to recognize that we don't naturally drift towards God. I mean, we want that. Sometimes we want to assume that. No matter how good of a person you may think you are, or even that sweet, kind person that you just respect and love so much in your life, even that person does not normally and naturally just drift towards God. No, we all drift away from God. We can look throughout the Bible, we can see this over and over again, examples of this happening, even all the way back to the very beginning. You know, we can see mankind, the beginning of mankind with Adam and Eve, that they were put into perfection. I mean, God gives them just everything that they could imagine, everything that they could want. God puts them into perfection there, the Garden of Eden, but still, they give in to sin. And you may see this in your own life even sometimes. Maybe it's within your past. Maybe you kind of can look back in your mind's eye to your past and you can think of the events of your life and kind of the direction and the paths of your life that you followed, and you think about how at times how you just drifted and drifted and drifted further away from God. Even those who are brought up in a God-honoring Christian home, sometimes we can drift away from God. Or maybe this happens to you today even. Maybe you kind of recognize within your life of how you are beginning to drift from God, or you have those moments where you feel so far from God, where you kind of like, it's like you pick your head up in the moment and you kind of become very aware of what's going on. Maybe I'm the only one that has these realization, these epiphany moments where it's like, what in the world's going on? How did I get to this point in my life? I think I've told you guys the story before. I remember being a kid, probably my son Brennan's age, probably about, you know, 10 years old. We were on a field trip to the Virginia Beach Aquarium, and I was at the shark tank. You know the shark tank? Every aquarium has the shark tank. It's like this wall, but it's glass, and the sharks are in there. And of course, you stand there as a kid, and you're like enthralled watching the sharks, and you're waiting for them to, because in your mind, sharks, as a kid, sharks eat everything. So you're waiting for it to eat something else. You know, you're kind of hoping it's going to happen. And so I'm standing there, and I'm watching the shark tank, and then something like clicked, and I looked around, and no one from my school is there. I don't recognize any faces anymore around me. And I'm like, oh, okay, so I should be somewhere else. And so I go wandering through the aquarium now, trying to find my schoolmates, my classmates, and no one. So finally, I find my way to the front desk, and I run up, and I tell them, hey, I'm with such and such school, or are they still here? And they say, I think they're actually getting on the buses right now. So I go running out, and they were literally like closing the doors, and I'm like, did no one notice that I'm not on the bus? You know, I'm freaking out. But it was in that moment that something like snapped, that I was very aware all of a sudden that I was not where I should be, or that I was not with who I should be, and I had kind of drifted off in some ways. And we have those moments in our life where we realize, and we pick up our head, and we realize in life, how did I get here? What am I doing here? How did I get to this point? Why do we drift? Why do we drift in our life? For one thing, I think there are distractions that we can have that will cause us to drift from God. Jesus once told a parable. He told lots of parables, but he told a parable once about a farmer who went out and was sowing some seed out on this different types of soil, and how some of the seed landed on good soil and some of the seed landed on not so good soil, and even some of it landed on this thorny soil, and it said that when it grew up that it was choked out by the plants that were around it. In Luke 8:14, it says this: "The seed that fell among the thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, by riches and pleasures, and they do not mature." You see, there are so many things in our life that want to pull us away, that want to cause us to drift away from God. Things that promise pleasure and contentment and promise escape for us, but really they only leave us feeling more and more empty and further away from God. We pursue these things, and really we think that it's a good thing. We think it's a profitable thing. We think it's going to be good for us. Maybe we think it's going to be good for our family. But we find that the more we pursue these things, the more that we're just heading further and further away from God. Maybe it's also for you. Maybe it's comparisons. Maybe comparisons cause you to drift from God. We look at our life and maybe the current situation or the setup that God has us sort of in at this moment. But then we sometimes look sort of across the way at someone else, and we begin to see them, and maybe sometimes we think, man, if only I had, and you can name it, if only I had their job or their house or their spouse or their children or their lifestyle or whatever it might be. And what it does is when we do these comparisons, it draws us away from depending on God, and it makes us think, well, if I just work a little bit harder, then I can finally be where they are. Or if I can just do this a little bit more, or if I can just do that a little bit harder, then finally I'll be where I should be. Because we forget that none of that stuff is anything about what we do. It's about how God blesses us, and we're no longer depending on Him. I mean, it's basically what happened with Adam and Eve. I mentioned this earlier about how they were in the midst of perfection, but then they give in to sin still. And we read in Genesis 3:6 the situation. It says, "When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye." I mean, remember again, she's got every kind of tree, every kind of fruit she could possibly want, but she's comparing now. And she says it was also desirable for gaining wisdom. She took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So what do you do about these comparisons? So then what do we do when we begin to kind of look at people and we begin to think, oh, if only? Well, I think it's so important that we take time to be reminded of God's goodness, of God's faithfulness, and remember how He has greatly provided for us. Otherwise, we almost turn to that kid who is sitting amongst a pile of toys and says, "I'm so bored. If only I had..." You know, we turn into the adult who is sitting amongst a pile of blessings and we say, "If only I had. My life would be so much better if only I had." And we forget the blessings that God has poured into our life. But maybe it's not distractions, maybe it's not comparison. I think sometimes it can also be laziness. Now, I don't mean laziness as in just sitting around all day. I don't mean that. There are a lot of you that work very, and most of you, all of you, work very, very hard in your life. You put in long hours, whether it be at your job or at your home. Maybe you even put in long hours for your health or for your family. You do a lot of stuff. But sometimes we can put in a lot of hours, a lot of long hours for something, but it not really have the lasting value that something else may have. Paul talks about it when he's writing to Timothy. In 1 Timothy, he says this. He says, "Have nothing to do with godless myths or old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come." You see, at times we can kind of fall into this rut. We can get to this point where we kind of... We started out feeling on fire for God. We were just amped up and ready to, you know, take on hell with a squirt gun. We were all about it. You know, we couldn't get enough Bible. We couldn't get enough God's people. We couldn't get enough serving. We couldn't get enough giving or whatever it might be. But then, well, I'm just really busy. Oh, you just don't understand how busy I am. You know, I get home at the end of the day and I'm just worn out. Or, man, I get up so early to begin with. I just can't add one more thing. Look, folks, we are all busy. But if we just leave it at that, well, I'm just busy, then we will never find a way to stay connected to God. But If we value our relationship with God, if we value knowing God and understanding how he's created us to live, understanding how he's created life to be for us, we understand that it takes time and it takes effort. Friends, if we aren't careful, if we aren't keeping focused on God, if we aren't remembering his goodness and continuing to grow in him, then we will slowly drift away before we even know it. And it'll be like Egypt and Pharaoh and God's people that will no longer know anything about this God anymore. When we allow ourselves to drift from God, we find ourselves in a dark and difficult place, just like God's people were. Let's go back to our text then in Exodus and verse 15 and pick up again. It says, the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, whose names were Shephara and Pua. Man, we never name kids like this anymore, right? It's just, they don't do this anymore. When you are helping the Hebrew women during childbirth on the delivery stool, if you see that the baby is a boy, kill him. But if it is a girl, let her live. The midwives, however, feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt told them to do. They let the boys live. Then the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and asked them, why have you done this? Why have you let the boys live? The midwives answered Pharaoh, the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women. They are vigorous and give birth before the midwives arrive. Good for them. So God was kind to the midwives, and the people increased and became even more numerous. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families of their own. The Pharaoh gave this order to all his people. Every Hebrew boy that is born, you must throw into the Nile, but let every girl live. So Pharaoh, his plan isn't working. You know, he had this plan at first where he was going to try and work God's people to death. He increases their workload and makes it more difficult for them. He thought, I'll bring them down through work. I'll wear them out, but that doesn't work. And so he thought, I'm going to try and get rid of the kids, but that still doesn't work. And if you know what happens later on, you know, we have this situation here where Pharaoh is calling for all these young boys to be killed. If you know what happens later on in the book, you may remember that eventually God doesn't forget about this sin, and he actually revisits this back on them. Probably the most severe and the greatest punishment that Pharaoh and his kingdom face is the death of the firstborn sons. But these midwives, they decide not to follow Pharaoh's orders. And they feared God is what it said. Why? Because they knew that they were disobeying Pharaoh, but they knew that there were greater consequences for their actions. You see, this nation had drifted from God. The Egyptian king no longer knew about God, no longer followed, no longer honored God. He felt threatened by God. He felt threatened by God's people. And so what do we usually do when we feel threatened? Well, we kind of react in sometimes severe ways. It's the old fight or flight kind of situation. Those that were in power are sometimes led to do some pretty dark and difficult things. And that's what Pharaoh did here. And he targeted these children, the weak, the helpless, the innocent. And even though Pharaoh was taking these desperate steps, these terrible measures, these widows, these midwives, they step in, and they're not willing to give in. You see, they were willing to stand up for what is right and what is true. You see, the thing I want us to learn from this is that no matter how dark it is, we must bring light. We have a responsibility. No matter how dark it might be around us, we need to bring God's light into a situation. There are times in our lives when it may seem pretty dark, pretty hopeless. And again, maybe it's times, many times it's because God's not at the center of someone's life that they're finding that they're in these dark and difficult times, that they've drifted from him. And they may even find that they're surrounded by people that have drifted from him. And so it may seem really desperate. It may seem really dark. But then we need to step back and we need to say, well, what am I supposed to do about this? Friends, the darker it is around us, the more even the smallest amount of light makes a difference. Have you ever experienced that before? You know, if I were to light a candle up here on stage right now, it wouldn't really make much of a difference because of so much light around us. But if we were to eliminate all the lights and block all the windows and it was dark in here, even the smallest amount of a light would make a huge difference. And perhaps even the light that these women showed in their life that they lived out maybe inspired others, maybe even inspired Moses' mother. We read about it in Exodus 2 now in verse 1. Now a man of the tribe of Levi married a Levite woman, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus, a basket for him, and coated it with tar and pitch. And then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. And we know what happens after that. Pharaoh's daughter is out there bathing, and she finds him. And there's a spider right in front of me right here. You can't even see this, but I wasn't going to be able to go on the rest of the morning. I'm sorry. But she sees him, and she brings him up. She draws him out. In fact, that's the name Moses means. It means to be drawn out of. And we don't really know the whole story of why Moses' mother, Jochebed, does this. Why, you know, maybe she's given up. Maybe she thought, I can't kill my son, but I can't put my family in danger. So maybe she's given up. Or maybe she is trying to just hide her son there in the reeds. Or maybe she knows that the Pharaoh's daughter will be there and is hoping that the Pharaoh's daughter will have mercy or pity on him. We don't really know the whole issue. But the bottom line is, because of the light that Moses' mother brought into this dark situation of saving her son, because of the light that these midwives brought into this dark situation of saving these children, God was able to carry out his plan through Moses. Which brings us, I think, all the way around to the bottom line for today. This last passage I want us to look at is really the crux of it all and really the most important part that I want us to see today. And this is in verse 25 of chapter 2. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. You see, God looks into this situation, and like he does all the time, he sees how far that they had drifted. He sees the darkness and the evil that they are surrounded by within their own lives and in the lives around them, and he does something about it. And he looks into our life today, and he sees how we drift from him. He sees how we wander away. And he sees the darkness, whether it's caused by us or whether it's caused by the people around us or the situations around us. You see, when we drift into darkness, God is ready to pull us out. You know, we could just spend the whole day talking about the ways that God has pulled each one of us out of darkness so many times. In fact, we're going to do some of that. We're going to look at some of these situations within the book of Exodus, and you're probably going to be reminded of some of these ways over the next several weeks as we study this book, and as we study more of Moses' life, about how God continually pulls us out of darkness. And as I told you before, you know, the whole reason that we look at this book, the whole reason we look at books like this, situations like this, is to be reminded of how God is faithful. This story is still true today. When we find ourselves drifting from God, when we find ourselves surrounded by darkness, all we need to do is to bring some of God's light into it. And so maybe you're in a dark time right now. Maybe it's because of all this COVID mess. Maybe there are things that are just bearing down on you. Maybe it's the whole thing of being away from people or wearing these masks, or maybe it's affecting your livelihood. Maybe it's affecting your family because of your job and things like that. And maybe you just feel really like in a dark, desperate spot right now, feeling very distant from God. Or maybe it's that whole thing of some of the choices that you have made. Maybe it's some of the things that you are doing in your life that's causing you to drift further and further away from God. I don't know what it might be. Or maybe you're looking at someone else in your life. Maybe look at a family member or a close friend and you just see them drifting further and further away from God, more and more into a dark, desperate place. And maybe they feel really distant from God. And maybe you need to bring some light and encouragement into their life. Either way, what I want to do is I want us to finish up this morning. I want to pray for us. And I want to ask God as we study this book over the next several weeks, I want to ask God as we do our best to kind of live out this in this dark time, in this weird time right now, I'm going to ask that God help each one of us not to drift further away from him, but to look to find ways to take steps closer and closer back to him and to move back into a closer relationship with him and to bring some light into these dark situations. So let me pray for us. God, we recognize that we never know what's going on. Sometimes we like to act like it, God. Sometimes we like to make these plans. Sometimes we like to try and pretend like we've got these ideas of what's going to happen. But God, we know we don't have a clue. And so because of that, God, we want to trust you. But sometimes we get distracted. Sometimes we look at other people's lives and we think that we can do something better to compare. Or sometimes we just get lazy. God, help us. Help us as we drift from you sometimes and pull us back in. Lord, I pray for those that are here this morning. Maybe there is someone here today who is struggling with that whole issue of drifting from you. Maybe even the fact that they come here every single Sunday. Maybe they're engaged with this church, but they just feel so far from you. They feel like they have drifted so far. Lord, I pray that you'd give them the courage and the push, the nudge, or whatever it might be for them to take those steps to come back closer. Maybe it's finding a friend within this church family. Maybe it's finding one of their leaders and confiding this in them and telling them that I just feel like I'm so far from God. And Lord, I pray you'd help us to love each other and to encourage each other and to pray for each other and build each other up as we do our best to stay close to you. But maybe there's also people here this morning, God, that are struggling with feeling just with this whole unknown factor of just not knowing what's coming next. God, would you give them encouragement? Lord, would you bless them with some peace of mind? Lord, would you give them an opportunity to maybe even shine some light into the darkness that they're facing ahead in their life? Lord, we want to be people that aren't just along for the ride or people that are just sitting on the sidelines. Lord, we want to be your people who are actively making a difference in the world around us, whether it's close to us or far away. God, use us and guide us and lead us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, a couple things before we wrap up this morning. One, if you did not get a I Love My Church sign, be sure you grab one on your way out. We'll have them out there in the foyer. And we would love for you to send us a picture of you with your sign there. You know, take a picture, send it on to us. You can email it to office@smithfieldchristian.com or you can text it to me or whatever it might be. We'd love to get one of those. Also, be sure, if you didn't get a bulletin on your way in, be sure you grab one on the way out because there are a lot of stuff happening, a lot of stuff starting up this week, even tonight. We don't want you to miss any of it. We want to try, and this is one of those ways that we keep from drifting by keeping connected to God's people, keeping connected to God's Spirit and His Word, and keeping that routine. Is that a good word? I don't know. We're going to say that, routine. We're keeping engaged with God on a regular basis. So, hey, we love you so much, and we hope you have a great week, and we'll see you. Thanks.